with you. Well, by second and last part, and that's the extension of the table. Well, next week we're going to deal with processes, so it's still going to genetics and technology, but it's less technical. That means it's not. Okay, let's recap a little bit. If you remember well, what we worked on last week was definition and concept about phonetics, then we had definition and concept about phonology, and then we talked about speech mechanism, focusing more specifically on the vocal cords, vocal folds, right? You have a nice idea of what's happening in your mouth, right? In your speech. Okay. So, today we're going to deal with speech mechanism again, but just describing the whole process. No worries, no bad picture or videos, but just the main process of how you articulate sounds in your body. Speech production anatomy, that is what do you need to use in your mouth, what's in your mouth, and what you need to use to produce a sound, a vowel or a consonant. And finally, we're going to focus on the phonemes of English, more specifically, so the sounds of English. So let's start with the speech mechanism first. So what you can have are four main steps, right, that I have described on the board, and a drawing to help you understand the way things are going, right? So, before describing the mechanism, you have to understand that most of the sounds of human language are called pulmonic egressive sounds. Pulmonic egressive sounds. So we're talking about pulmonic egressive. What does it mean? It looks like a technical word, but it's not really difficult. Pulmonic is because it comes from the lungs, right? It comes from the lungs, so we said pneumonic. Egressive is because the air comes out. That's simply. Okay? That's. So it simply means that you use your lungs and the air that comes out from the lungs is released in certain ways. Okay, so that's what pneumonic egressive means. So on the picture, in the screen, we can see two lungs. And the way the air is going out is indicated with the arrows. So first of all, the air comes from the lungs and goes up through what we call the glottis. So this is the black circle. Remember well, I think now the glottis, where are your vocal cords. So that's represented with the black circle. So when the air is in the glottis, this is where the phonation happens. The phonation, that is the vibration or not. So the phonation happens in the glottis. And then the air goes out in your throat at the level of the pharynx, more precisely, so in your throat. And this is where the overall nasal process happens. The overall nasal process happens. So what does that mean? It's just the idea that you decide to use only your mouth to release the air or the nose. So you have two possibilities when producing a sound. You can release the air through the mouth or through the nose. When you produce nasal sounds, so when you say nasal sounds, it could be the consonant m, n, for example, or some vowels in French. When you say on, en, un, these are nasal vowels. What happens? When you pronounce them, you know the yellow circle here that you can see on the drawing, the yellow circle? That's the velar, what we call the velar. Opens and then the air can go into the nose. That's what happens when you produce a nasal sound. articulation. So when the air is at the level of the mouth, then what happens? So instead of articulation, then you're going to use your speech organs. So you have different speech organs, okay? We're going to focus on some of them, which are really important. And the first one is the tongue, that you can see in red in the drawing, right? So the tongue. Another one that you can see, which is indicated with this green circle, is called the alveolar ridge. So it's the alveolar ridge. That's something that is just behind the upper teeth. So take the tip of your tongue and try to touch what is just behind your teeth. Can you feel like a bump, a little bump? That's normal. That's the alveolar ridge. That's it, right? You use it when, for example, you want to pronounce the sound T. The tip of the tongue touches the alveolar ridge. If not, it means that your T is not pronounced correctly in English, right? That's the alveolar ridge. And then you have the hard palate. So you can see it with the blue circle. The hard palate. That's in the middle of your mouth. Okay. At the end of the hard palate, you have the soft palate, which is the villain. That's the same thing. Villain, soft palate. It's soft, actually. So that's what you have at the end of the palate. Helping intranasal sounds and all the sounds. And finally, something important is the lips. The upper lips and the lower lips. Some sounds are articulated with the lips. Others are just with the tongue and something else, not necessarily the lips. So that was for the anatomical part of your body, right? So let's focus on the sound now, the phonemes of English. From a phonological point of view, if you remember well, phonology is the study of the pronunciation changes that are available in the pronunciation of words in a language, right? And also the restriction, what is possible or not. So that's the phonology. So if we consider vowels, English vowels, from a phonological point of view, we can say that we have about 20 phonological choices. 20 phonological choices. That's the basic. Okay? We can have more, but considering sounds, that's what we're going to have. Here you have the first example of 12 phonological choices among vowels. What we call simple vowels, monophthongs. That is one sound. So we have 12 simple vowels. You'll see next semester that actually you have 14. But for now, let's keep it on 12. The first line, you have on the first column an example word. And then on the second column, you have the sound, the phoneme, which corresponds to the pronunciation of the vowel of this word. Okay? So what you can see is the phonetic symbol used for the vowels. It's a symbol that comes from the International Phonetic Alphabet, what we call the IPA. So, International Phonetic Alphabet. So, when you have symbols from this alphabet, it can describe any language of the world. Right, but of course here we focus on English. So if you look at the 12 vowels here, the have about P. The second line is hip, so you have about E. What's the difference between the two, between E and A? Yeah. Exactly, that's the length of the sound, the length of the sound. So, when you look at a phonetic symbol and you see two dots like this, it means that the sound is long. Okay, so each time you see two dots, you will know that the sound is long. So E versus E. Then you have the word head, the vowel in S. Then you have the word hat, the vowel in A. Then you have mother, but the vowel in A. That's a big A. You need to open your mouth very, very quickly. And heart, it's a long R. Then hot, it's an O sound. And then you have a long O for hot. Then you have oop for hood. A long oo for shoes. A long er for girl. And a short er for the or vanilla. Okay, so you see that you work in pairs with long and short. Long and short. For each type of vowels. What you can have as well in English, and that does not exist in French, for example, are what we call the diphthongs. So diphthongs, you have D for two, in Louise it means two, and thongs, it means sounds. So two sounds. And if you look at the symbol, well, you can see that it's composed of two things, right? So for example, X plus E, it gives A, like this. Then you have I, oi, ear, air, ur, o, and ow at the end. Okay? Eight diphthongs. You have eight diphthongs in English. Eight possibilities. Something else which exists in English but still not in French, for example, are another category of the triphthongs. What's a triphthong? Well, if you follow the definition, you have three for three and then sounds for sound, right? So three sounds. So what you're going to do is you take a diphthong and you add the E at the end, the E sound, the vowel E. So for example, if you want to pronounce the word fire, if you listen to it, fire, I-E, you have A plus E plus E. So three sounds, I-E. So you will have something like this. And it's just a combination of diphthong plus at the end. So that's the difference of opinion of theory, but the result is the same. You need to pronounce two sounds, okay? If we look at these vowels from a phonetical point of view, in that case, we're going to look at articulation. So what is happening in the vowel? When you pronounce a vowel, okay? If you remember well, we said last week that for all vowels, you have vibration of the vocal cords. So you can try, you can put your fingers in your throat and say E, I, I, whatever the vowel you're going to give it, you will feel the vibrations of the vocal cords. Okay? vibrations. The second characteristic that you can see written on the screen is that the airflow is never interrupted. That is, the airflow comes from the vent going up and out of your mouth or nose, and is never interrupted somewhere. Okay? That's the second characteristic of the funnel, the uninterrupted airflow. So the airflow is continuous, no interruption, and you have vibration at the vocal cords. To articulate a vowel, you will need the tongue, the jaw, and lips. If you look at the MII images, what's the difference, for example, between E, N, and the bottom images are R? The common point is the kind of tube that you can see going from the pharynx until the lips, right? So they all have this kind of tube where the air is going through, okay? But then you have differences. So E, U are different from A, O. The movement of the tongue and the movement of the mouth, you said, or the lips? The lips? Well, both actually. So if you look at the images at the top, you see that the tongue is raised, right? And it's the E at the front and U moving backward, towards the back, right? But you see that the tongue is raised. And when you pronounce A or O, the tongue doesn't raise. It's maintained at the lower position. Okay? And for A, it's at the front of your mouth, but when you say A, it's lower but moving backwards. Is it okay? Is it here? Yes? Okay. And of course, you can see that the lips and the mouth are different. When you do A and A, the mouth is very open. But when you do E, U, the mouth is not really open. Right? And the lips are different as well. The lips are different. So that's what we're going to need to describe a vowel. To describe a vowel, not just to describe it, but when you describe it, you understand how to produce correctly a vowel in English. Sometimes you just change one of these criteria and the vowel is different. So that's what you need to understand, what you need to do in your mouth to produce the right vowel. So this is what is indicated here in the diagram, what we call the vocalic diagram, the vowel diagram. These vocalic shapes for vowels represented the four criteria used to describe the vowel. The first one is the horizontal axis. If you look at the horizontal axis, you have front, central, and back. That's the position of the tongue. Is the tongue front, as we've seen with the E, or is the tongue central, means it doesn't really move, it's in the central of the mouth, or is the tongue moving backwards like this? So for the oo sound that you see on the images. So first criteria is the position of the tongue. Is it front, central, or back? Second criteria, the vertical axis. We can see close, not close, close. If you close your mouth, no sound is right. So you close. close mid, open mid, and open. Okay? So the more you go down, the more the vowel is an open vowel. So if you do E, you will see that the mouth is just a little bit open. But if you do A, the mouth is very, very open. Okay? So second criterion, the opening of the mouth, we say the aperture. Criterion, the aperture of the mouth, the opening of the mouth, with four possibilities. Then the first criterion is what we call the tension, that is the sound long or short? Why is it tension? Well, simply because when you pronounce a long sound, you have a tension in your jaw. When you say E, the jaw is tension here, has tension, right? When you have tension, well, we say the vowel is tense. On the contrary, when you pronounce a short vowel, well, in that case, you have no tension in the jaw and the vowel is lax. Okay, so tense versus lax. So be careful when you pronounce the English vowel. Most of the time, the length is not enough long when you pronounce it. Okay, so you should be careful with the long sound, more specific. The last criterion to describe the vowel is the rounding of the lips. The rounding of the lips. You have three possible positions. Spread lips, when you pronounce the E, the long E like this, E, you spread your lips. Then you have the central, that is you just open your mouth like nothing else that happens, right? And at the end, you have something rounded, for example, or making a round with your lips. Okay, so three possible positions: spread, neutral, or rounded. So here we have our fourth criteria to describe the vowel, the position of the tongue, the aperture of the mouth, the tension of the sounds, and the rounding of the lips, the position of the lips. Okay? Of course, you can also represent diphthongs in the diagram. If you draw a line between A and E, you will have A, right, at the bottom, at the bottom. And we can also represent the triphthongs. This What is the diagram representing more precisely, more concretely? If you look at it, well, you should see yourself. That's the back side of your face. Look, that's you. That's you pronouncing the vowels. And you see that when you pronounce the E, which is the front side, well, it is positioning your mouth as a front. Okay, so this diagram actually represents your mouth, right? And gives you the four criteria. So we just described here the sound of English, but more specifically the sound and British English. Remember when we talked about accents? I told you that this was the sound and British English, so the RP, right? So the repeat pronunciation. But of course, if we go on to other accents, well, in that case, you will find other vowels that are possible and other phonetic symbols. Let's hear a sentence pronounced by a Cockney speaker. Did you get the sentence? Or not so? Nothing? Okay. There is one specific word which is important, which is the word make.
For someone. What's up, my cat got your tongue, is it?
What is wrong, my friend? Lots of words, things like that, right? And not this kind of syntax or structure. So just to show you that here in Southern British English, you pronounce and you are used to pronounce the word made with the vowel A. But if you hear a Cockney accent, what do you hear? Something different, right? Did you hear the difference? No?
Mike. Mike.
Mate.
Mike.
Do you hear the difference? Okay. So it's more like I and not A. Right, so it will be probably something like this. Not in the phonological system of the received pronunciation, right? But which is in the phonological system of the Cockney accent, right? So just to show you that it exists other symbols to describe each accent, each variety of English, and of course any language of the world. One vowel more specifically, among all the vowels we just saw, there is one which is really specific and important for you. This vowel has a name, and this is called a schwa, S-C-H-W-A, a schwa pronunciation, schwa in French. So why is this vowel particularly important? Well, first of all, because this vowel is the most frequent vowel that you're going to find in English. Okay? And as you can see in the example, you can find it, you have it in red, it's represented in a red color. You have it in about, photography, submit, tiger, student, a cup of coffee, she was hungry, give them some paper, black and white. So you see that there is something typical with this vowel, this sound, is that there is no correspondence between the spelling and the sound. You can have any type of letters, I, A, E, O, it could be pronounced with the schwa. Most of the time you can have a kind of correspondence between spelling and sound. For example, when you have the spelling EA, like in the word C, you know that when you have EA letters in English, you have at least two possibilities, a long E or a E sound, when you don't know how to pronounce the sound, okay? For the schwa, you don't have this kind of strict correspondences, any letters could work, okay? So that's the first thing about the schwa. It does not correspond to a specific letter. The other thing about the schwa is that you cannot find it in the stressed syllable. Do you know what a stressed syllable is? When you take a word, for example, let's say the student, that you have here. Student, when you pronounce a word of several syllables, at least two, one syllable is more important than the others. When we say student, student, is it the first syllable or the second syllable which is more important? What would you say? Student. Do you say student or do you say student? The first one or the second one? The first one? Yes, exactly. You say student. So you see that you have to choose a syllable and put more strength on it. That's the stress, what we call the stress. So student is stressed on the first syllable. So the second syllable is unstressed. Well, when you have an unstressed syllable, you have a high probability to find the schwa in the pronunciation. It's not always the case, but 70-80% of the time, you will find the schwa pronunciation. Okay, so you see that you have a lot with this vowel. Why are we talking about this vowel more particularly? It's because that's something interesting that you have to fit with these vowels. You speak French, most of you speak French, right? As your native language, and this vowel exists in French. It's the E that you have in le, me, je, right? But when this vowel appears in English, French speakers have a lot of difficulty pronouncing it. So you can hear things like a student, or I don't know, tailleur, teacher, right? So you have other vowels, but not the E sound. So when you say, for example, she was hungry, it's a E sound, she was, and not she was. So it's just that your brain responded to the letters. Your brain see the A letter, she was, so you say, I think that she was. It's a E sound, she was. Is it okay with this vowel? Yeah, get the idea? So just to recap about the vowels. Vowels may be described in terms of phonology, phonetics, acoustics, as we've seen, and auditions, well, perception, right? You have about 20 phonological choices about the vowel, that's what you have to remember. The cardinal vowels can be used to describe any vowel of any language. And finally, the vowel quality can be described according to four criteria that we have written down. So describing front, back, tense, lap, etc. So what you have to be able to do, the learning objective, is to identify the phonological vowels of English. Okay, so recognize the vowels. Use the appropriate vowel descriptors. So as we said, front, back, etc. And be able to explain what is shown on the diagram, to explain the diagram. Okay? So let's move on the consonant sounds now. The consonants of English. For the vowels, you only have two criteria for the consonant. So to understand how to produce a consonant, you have two things to understand. Okay? So two criteria. The first one is the places of articulation, the place of articulation of the consonant. So if you remember well, we said that the airflow for the vowels is continuous, right? This is not the case for consonants. When you produce a consonant in English, the airflow will be stopped somewhere at the place of articulation and then released, okay? But there will be something happening in the vocal tract. question that you should answer with this first criteria is where is the airflow interrupted in the vocal tract? Okay, where is the airflow interrupted? You have a first example here on the screen. First picture on the left. A consonant which is articulated and the air is interrupted at the level of the lips. Because you use both lips to articulate the vowel, and then the air is lit, but because you use both lips, like when you say b, b, or m, m, both lips touch, right? In that case, we say that the consonant is bilabial, by two labials per lips, bilabial. So that's what you can see from the drawing on the board. Another example of place of articulation is, remember your bump, the alveolar bridge? Well, that's it. Look at the drawing, you can see that the tip of the tongue touches the alveolar bridge, right? In that case, we say that the consonant is alveolar because the air is stopped at the level on the alveoli, and then to breathe. So when you look at the places of articulation throughout the vocal tract, you have actually 10 possibilities of places, okay, for any language. For English, you only have 8 possibilities. So the number 4, the dental, does not exist in English, and the number 9 doesn't exist, the uvular doesn't exist in English. So you have 8 possibilities, 8 places of articulation, according to the consonant. Look at the table here. Well, you will see that you have these possibilities: bilabial, labial, dental on the horizontal axis. So bilabial, labial, dental, alveolar. So what you can do is take the consonant, try to practice, and you will see what part of the mouth is involved. What your tongue touches with the other organs. Is it the alveolar, the palate, the velum? And you will understand it, right? You don't need to learn by heart these things. You do the consonant and you should feel what's happening in your mouth. So this horizontal axis was for the first criterion, right? The airflow. The second criterion is the vertical axis, is how the airflow interacts. You will have different ways to pronounce the consonant. Do you remember when we talked about the spectrum, we studied the word spent, and I told you that the s sound was specific. You have dark shade at the top of the spectrum, okay? And these dark shades were a characteristic of this kind of consonants, and others like what happens to the air when you pronounce them? Do you feel anything in your mouth? Do you feel something specific which is different from the air is frictioned. So when you do the air is frictioned, right? In that case, we talk about fricative. That's the second line of the table, fricative. So what happens to the air? It is friction at different places of the mouth. Sometimes it's with the lips, sometimes it's the tongue and something else, the lips and something else, that's the one. When you produce the first consonant, the first line, but the, they're specific as well and different from French. that the air is blocked, and then suddenly release. That's the closure that you have on your butt. Okay, the air is blocked. So at the level of the lips, for butt, at the level of the alveolar, for butt, and at the level of the jugular, for butt. But roughly release. So when the air is stopped, is blocked, we say that the consonants are called stops. Okay, stop consonants. The third line is affricate. Well, that's a mixture of a stop and fricative. What happens is that the air is blocked, and when the air is released, it's not rusty like the stops, but it's friction like the fricative. So when you do you start with the air which is blocked, and then when you release it, it's friction, and it gives fortune like this. Okay? That's line number three, affricate. The next one, nasal sound. So I think now we know how it works with the nasal sound. So m, n, ng. The air goes out from the nose, right? So there are nasal consonants. Then the liquid. The liquid, when you do l or r, you have your tongue like this, and the air goes by the side of your tongue. The air is not all around the mouth, but just at side, both sides of your tongue, which is raised a little bit like this. And the air goes by the side. Okay, that's what happens when you do the rough move. You don't know, of course. And the last one is the glide. So what here? The glide, just because the air is gliding when you pronounce the word here. Okay. They're also called semi-vowel, because when you say work, it's close to a vowel. Work, yeah, it's close to e, right? So they're also called semi-vowels. Is it okay with the consonant? So two main criteria. The places of articulation, so where is the airflow interrupted, okay, and how the manner of articulation. The manner of articulation. How is the airflow interrupted? Is it stop? Is it friction? Is it in the nose? F1. Just as we did for the vowels, we're going to focus on one specific consonant, which is the glottal stop. Remember the glottal stop? We dealt with it last week. For the symbols, it's like a question mark, but without the box. So just the first part of the question mark. Here you have an example of the word glottal, pronounced differently, that is according to three different accents. The first one on the left is glottal, that is with standard British English, so the received pronunciation. You see that you have the T in the middle of the word glottal. Well, in standard English, you pronounce it T. In standard American, you will have something like glottal. Glottal, like this. That is, the T sound is pronounced like a D. Or what we call a flap C. Glottal. That's what you can hear, for example, when you say better. In English, now we say it's better in American English. The T is flapped, okay? Better. Then another possible pronunciation, again with the famous Cockney accent, is with the glottal stop. That is, the T is replaced by a glottal stop, and in that case we say glottal. With no T, no D, there is nothing. The air is blocked, and then release vocal. Glottal. Okay. So you see that you have different ways to pronounce the same word according to the accent. And that the glottal stop actually is the frequent way to say it, not only in Cockney, but you will find it in other accents. Hmm? So understanding that once you have the T letter, this T must be followed by another consonant. So if the T is followed by a vowel, it doesn't work. So if you look at the example here that you have on the slide, rat trap, elephant go, internet horn, all the T at the end of the word are followed by another consonant. Trap is T, gun, G, and horn is P, right? So it works. In that case, you can replace the T at the end by the glottal stop. So you can see rat trap, elephant gun, internet horn, right? So that's the rule that you have to remember. And if the glottal stop is stoppable, when the T is followed by a consonant, all right? So the moral of the story is just that the glottal stop is quite common and frequent in English.